Galaw-galaw kay harot-harot tingnan maliksi, di mapigil ang gaslaw. Galaw-galaw ang lahat ginagalaw, napakaharot at pakialam. Galaw-galaw.
So sabi galaw ko, magkaroon tayo ng theoretical situation. Ang Comelec chairman si Sheriff Abbas, is as we all know, is a pamangkin ni Iqbal, MILF. And MILF, as we all know, has been supported by Malaysia. Pag nagkaroon ng referendum sa Mindanao, halimbawa, at sasabihin ng Comelec chairman, panalo ang yes, ang tanong, halimbawa, gusto pa ninyo humiwalay na sa Pilipinas at sumama sa Federation of Malaysia to become the 14th state of the Federation of Malaysia. Pag sinabi ng Comelec na panalo ang yes, at ni-recognize ng US, ni-recognize ng United Kingdom, ni-recognize ng Malaysia, ni-recognize ng Saudi Arabia, tapos na po ang usapan. Wala na ang Mindanao. We would have lost a big chunk of our national territory. Ang sinasabi ko po, yung US, United Kingdom, Saudi Arabia, at saka Malaysia, meron pong historical basis yan. Kasi sila ang nagsama-sama just 10 days after our independence on July 4, 1946 para mawala sa atin ang Saba. No? Hindi tayo pinagtanggol ng Amerika, bagkos pinampihan ng Amerika yung United Kingdom at saka yung mga Islamic powers. No? Although wala pang Malaysia noon, yung Malaysia under pa ng British. Malaya. So, merong unilateral declaration yung Queen of England, dineklara na henceforth, without any consultation with the Republic of the Philippines, henceforth, the territory known as Sabah or Norponeo shall belong to the British Empire. Kaya ngayon po, para malubos-lubos na nila, kasi nakadiskubre ng langis, natural gas, at saka uranium dyan sa Mindanao, pag binasa ninyo yung Bangsang Oro Basic doon, patuloy-tuloy na pinapanggit doon yung langis, natural gas, at saka uranium in several provisions, yun naman po ang gusto makuha ngayon ng Shell na ang may-ari ay yung British at saka yung British Petroleum, Exxon Mobil ng Amerika, Petronas ng Malaysia, Aramco ng Saudi Arabia, etc. etc. So, nakakatakot po, no? Ngayon, kami po, marami nakakaalam dito, matagal na nating binabanata ng CPP at PNDF, no? Sapagkat tayo po ay nationalist. Pero sa pagkakataong ito, hindi po makatwira na basta-basta lang babarilin ang ating mga kapatid na Pilipino. No? Bakit po pinag-iigpitan ng gusto yung CPP and PNDF na hindi naman sila naglalayo na ihiwalay ang anumang teritoryo ng Pilipinas mula sa Pilipinas? Pero napakaluwag, pinaglalaban ng revolutionary government ko, no, yung Bangsamoro Basic Law at Federalism. Alam po ba niya ibig sabihin ng Bangsamoro? Malaysian word po ang bangsa, which means independent country or state. Ang Moro po is a Spanish word which means Islamic. Put them together, Islamic state. Yan po ang bangsa Moro. Ang basic to po, ibig sabihin yan ay constitution. Synonymous po constitution. Kaya ang ating framers of the 1987 constitution sa section 18 of the Article of Local Government, ang ginamit na salita ay organic act, hindi basic to. The Congress shall enact an organic act for its autonomous region. Ang China po, napakalaking bansa, napakalaking populasyon, hindi nag-a-adapt ng federalism. Ganun din po ang Indonesia, which is the biggest archipelago. Ganun din po ang Greece, which is the next biggest archipelago. Kasi pagka-archipelago ka, malaki ang population mo o malaki ang territory mo. Delikado po ang federalism. Dahil nga po sa inherent right of every state to secede from the Union, just through the means of referendum. Isa pa po, tatlong regions lang po, sa pag-aaral ng NEDA, Philippine Statistical Authority, tsaka sa University of the Philippines, tatlong regions lang po ang may kakayahan tumindi sa kanilang sariling paa. Yung Region 3, yung NCR, at saka yung Region 4A. Ibig sabihin, pag nagkaroon tayo ng federalism, useless, sapagkat isasubsidize pa rin ng tatlong regions na ito, yung mga ibang states. At ang isa pa pong di maganda dyan, tataas po ang gastos ng gobyerno. Tumatuwa po dyan yung IMF World Bank at saka yung mga local banks kasi mangungutang ang ating gobyerno sapagkat magkakaroon ng another layer of government. In fact, every state will have its own armed forces, no? Yung tinatawag na state troopers or national guard. Department, Legislative Department, Judicial Department. So, another layer of government, magpapatayo ka ng Malacanang sa bawat state, magpapatayo ka ng Batasan sa bawat state, magpapatayo ka ng mga edifices at saka puno-puno ng personnel yan. Malaking gastos yan, ano? Tapos, ang talagang dahilan po para tayo umunlad, hindi po yung federalism, hindi po yan problema. Nililigaw yung ating isipan eh. Ang talaga pong problema, hindi tayo nag-a-adapt ng nationalist industrialization, kaya hindi tayo umunlad. Ang susi po sa kaunlaran ay nationalist industrialization. Basahin yung libro ni Hajun Chang, yung protege ni Joseph Stiglitz. Malalaman ninyo, industrialization ang susi sa kaunlaran. Ngayon, sa isa pa pong delikado sa revolutionary government, kung ito ay gagamitin para sa oil gas. Kasi sa ngayon, linggo-linggo, tumataas ang gasolina, tumataas ang diesel, LPG, kerosene, etc. Buwan-buwan, tumataas ang kuryente, buwan-buwan, tumataas ang tubig, pati ang toll fee sa mga daan, at mga oil gas ang nakikinabang. Wala pong indication na itong present government ay anti-oil gas. Bagamat meron siyang mga service, anti-oil gas, pero kakaiba yung kanyang ginagawa. Iba yung salita, iba yung actions. So wala pong indication na gagamitin ng revolutionary government para labanan ng oligarchs. Bagkos lahat ng indication, ito ay gagamitin para supilin ang mamamayan, supilin ang consumers, supilin ang workers para mawalan na ng karapatan. Ano? Para to stifle dissent. Ngayon po, yung rice cartel ay tila pinapanigan din ng gobyerno sapagkat this is the only time in our history na anihan, imbis na bumaba ang presyo ng bigas, tumaas po ang presyo ng bigas. At kita rin po natin yung ginawa ng mga ilan lang dyan sa Baclaran at iba pang lugar, ginamit yung mga armado para wasamin yung mga kawawang pedicab, yun na nga naman sasakyan na mahihirap, winawasak pa. Pwede naman pagbayarin na lang multa, bakit mawasamin pa? Pati yung kanilang mga paninda, inutang lang yun eh. So, wala pong indikasyon na gagamitin para sa mahihirap ang revolutionary government. Isa pa po yung trade, yung tax reform, yung tax paid reform, acceleration and inclusion. Fake reform po yan, faking reform yan. Kasi inililipat niya yung burden of paying taxes from the oligarchs to the ordinary people by lessening the tax burden of the rich, the big corporations, and transferring it to sugary foods, salty foods, oil, petroleum products, and especially coal. Karamihan po ng ating ginagamit na kuryente ay galing sa coal. Pag tinaas mo ang tax sa coal, ay ang computation po ay 28 pesos per kilowatt hour ang tataas ng ating kuryente. We already have the most expensive electricity in the world, tataas pa po. So, yung jeepney naman po, nakita natin, pinapanigan yung mga dayuhan para bumili tayo ng pampalit sa jeepney na nagkakalaga ng 1.6 million per unit na imported na hindi naman matibay no, sa ating road conditions. At yung 100% foreign ownership of everything, yun din daw ang isa nilang dahilan kung gusto nila, kung bakit gusto nilang magkaroon ng revolutionary government. That's counter-revolutionary. Kaya nga nakasulat sa Constitution 6040 at pinasa ko kanina, lahat ng natural resources are owned by the state. Ang layunin po ng mga framers ng ating Constitution, kasi ito hango pa sa panahon nila Recto, no? Panahon nila Diosdado Macapagal, no? Recto, 1934 Constitutional Convention, Macapagal, 1971 Constitutional Convention, pati yung Malolos Constitution, lahat po yan nationalist and socialistic. Pag pinalitan na natin ang ating Constitution, mawawala na po yung nationalist provisions, ibebenta na ang ating bansa sa foreigners, at ang makikinabang oligarchs and foreigners. Kaya hindi po revolutionary yan, that is counter-revolutionary. Kaya yan po ay aming mahigpit na tinutulan. At nakasulat na po sa ating constitution na merong dapat autonomy. Hindi mo na panghabain, ha? Dapat merong autonomy. Kaya hindi na kailangan ng federalism. So yan po ang mga dahilan. Delikado-delikado po ang revolutionary government sapagkat wala nang tatakbuhan ng mga Pilipino at ang mamamayanin dyan ay mga dayuhan at mga oligarchs. Yun lamang po.
Next po is Professor Danilo Araw, College of Mascom ng Indigiliman.
Kanyang topic, syempre mga kapatid, ayan po itong concept implication of revolutionary government to the media.
This will just be a very, very short discussion because the effect can be summed up in just very few words. It will be detrimental to media. So why is it detrimental? For the simple reason that what will happen in a revolutionary government is basically a dictatorship. So, of course, I do agree with what the previous speaker said, regarding a monarchy that will arise from it. But the more appropriate term, insofar as social science research is concerned, is dictatorship. A dictatorship that is no different from the Marcos era, where the media have been attacked relentlessly. And just imagine what is happening right now. Right now, there is no revolutionary government. There is supposed to be a semblance of normalcy as far as our structures are concerned. But the media are being relentlessly attacked by no less President Duterte himself. President Duterte has time and again threatened various media outfits regarding allegedly unfair reportage. I'm not sure if there is somebody here who's working for the Philippine Daily Inquirer, but we all know what's happening in terms of transfer of ownership there. While the Prietos and the Rufinos may argue that their decision is just simply a business decision, we all know that there is a political angle to it, and it is understandable that the Prietos and the Rufinos would be silent for now, lest their business interests be affected. Rappler and ABS-CBN have also been at the receiving end for allegedly critical reportage. Don't get me wrong, the dominant media would have its share of weaknesses insofar as reportage is concerned. But no government official, not even the president himself, has the right to threaten the media. Let's talk about media killings. 5 journalists have been killed under the watch of Duterte. I'm not saying that he was the one who pulled the gun, far from it. But his enabling environment of letting, you know, the coercive forces of the state deal with the alleged drug addicts and drug lords with impunity would have a telling effect, not just on journalists and media workers, but also on activists, as well as other professionals who are perceived to be critical of the administration. As a teacher of journalism, what we always have to remember, and the thing that we always instill in our students, is that journalism is adversarial by nature. That is partly the reason why we are called the fourth estate. We want to assure check and balances with those in power. But this government doesn't want check and balance. That would partly explain why the current COMELEC chair was forced to resign, lest he face an impeachment trial. That would also explain why the Supreme Court Chief Justice right now is going through a harrowing ordeal of impeachment, even if the lawyer who filed the impeachment complaint doesn't really have first-hand information regarding the accusations that he made. Sometimes you even wonder how that lawyer passed the bar exam, but I guess that's beside the point. But nevertheless, what we have to remember here is that the media are now at the crosshairs and we are now at a critical juncture. So, during the time of martial law, some of us may be old enough to remember what happened then. Journalism and activism were one and the same. Because the best journalists in the country were forced to oppose martial law. They assumed the role of an activist. Why? Because journalism cannot function in a regime of authoritarianism, dictatorship, and fascism. Journalism can only exist if there is democracy. Press freedom is a cornerstone of democracy. So in times like this, it is part of not just the advocacy, it is the responsibility of all journalists and media workers to oppose proposals for a revolutionary government or even federalism and even the current actuations of President Duterte himself as he tries to even justify media killings. You remember his statement way back in May 2016, a few months into his swearing into office as the next president of the country. As President-elect, in mentioning the so-called 3 types of journalists, he said that one of the 3 types more or less had it coming insofar as killings are concerned. In other words, if you are a corrupt journalist, which was one classification, which was one classification of types of journalists in the eyes of Duterte. What Duterte was saying was that those who are corrupt had it coming in so far as killings are concerned. In other words, they deserve to be killed. This was in reference to what happened in 2003 when Jun Labo, who was critical of Duterte, was killed under still mysterious circumstances, and the mastermind isn't known until now. So these are the reasons why opposition to the revolutionary government is a natural response among journalists and media workers. And we also have to remember that during the time of martial law, journalists and activists went hand in hand insofar as making sure that we will see an end to the dictatorship. Right now, we have a dictatorship. We have a tyranny. We have a fascist ruler there in Malacanang Palace who may act like a joker and a clown but is inherently a killer. He kills and he is proud of it. The difference with Marcos was that during the time of martial law from 1972 to 1986, at least there was some effort to cover up or to deodorize so-called human rights violations at that time. There was denial with regard to killings, but now everything is quite brazen. He was even proud to say that at 16 years old, he already killed someone. What kind of a president do we have? He is a fascist, he is a dictator, he is a tyrant. He is an enemy of press freedom. And that's why, if you go by what Edmund Lampet says in his book, Committed Journalism, there are five principles of journalism. Let me just enumerate them briefly. Truth-telling, justice, stewardship, humaneness, and freedom. With regard to the last principle of journalism, which is freedom, what Lambeth says there is that in times of crisis, it is a journalist's responsibility to fight for freedom. Because how can we exercise our profession if there is no freedom to begin with? Do we want to become the house shows? Do we want to become the environmental journalists that Duterte would want to picture all journalists and media workers to be? Of course not. Because in order to uphold the highest normative standards of the profession, what we need to ensure is that we can have an enabling environment toward the responsible and responsive use of the power of the pen, of the keyboard, and the microphone, so that we can have the proper, relevant information to help in the shaping of public opinion. So these are the challenges to the media right now. We are facing a tyrant, a dictator, a fascist, the unholy trinity in one, in the person of Duterte. That's all for now. Thank you very much.
Galaw-gaw kay harot-harot tingnan maliksi, di mapigil ang gaslaw. Galaw-gaw ang lahat ginagalaw, napakaharot.